How are you, Merrill?
I'm great, Rich. Nice to speak with you.
Well, we were when we were Sunday night after the game, we were just wondering, who should we have on the show this week? Right, Brock? And we're all like, we got to get...
Had to get him.
We had to get Merrill Reese back on the show. Who were you thinking of when you were making that final call, Merrill? Not what, who in particular. Was there somebody?
At that moment, at the final call?
Yeah.
No, I was just... Of course, I couldn't hold my breath because I had to speak. I was just focusing on that call. And, you know, it's funny because people ask me, do you write something? Do you jot something down for a moment like that? I might have at the first Super Bowl in 80 that I did after the 80 season have tried to prepare myself for such a moment. And probably after the 2004 season when the Eagles played the Jacksonville game against the Patriots, I had some thoughts in my mind, but I said on this one, you know, just let your heart talk and just react. I had nothing. All I was thinking about was I hope that we didn't see a repeat of some of those things that Aaron Rodgers had done when he threw it for the end zone and a Packer came down with the ball. I just didn't want to see that. That's all I was thinking about. I just wanted to see the officials wave off and show us an incompletion.
So then let me give you the floor and voice what this means for the city of Philadelphia with you essentially for what, except for a stint in the armed forces, have been around the city of Philadelphia your whole life, Merrill.
Yeah. I mean, I was a naval officer when I came out of college for a tour of duty as a public affairs officer. And then after that, I went through the little stations and up to doing the Eagles pre- and post-game show, one thing after the other. Mm-hmm. So this is my 41st year doing the Eagles. So I have been here for a long time. And I said something to Doug Peterson yesterday. But we came back, we flew in, the fans outside the airport were lining the streets, and they were cheering on the other side of the fence. And as we walked to our buses that would take us back to our cars at the Eagles training site, the players said, hey, let's go see them. And they walked over to the fence, and the fans started cheering and singing Fly, Eagles, Fly. And I said to Doug, I said, back in 1960, as a kid, when the 1960 Eagles championship team came back, well, actually, it was when they played the championship in Philadelphia. But right before that, when they clinched the Eastern Division of the NFL, which put them into the championship game, there was no Super Bowl then, I said to a friend of mine, let's go down to the airport. I thought we would be the only two to see the team come back, but there were hundreds, not thousands. But I was once upon a time on the other side of that fence,
awesome,
screaming out the names of my favorite Eagles. And then to be a part of it yesterday was just an incredible, incredible feeling.
I mean, it is truly just remarkable. Who that you've been around throughout this drought? Championship drought that's no longer with us, do you think you would love to see have the ability to see what we're witnessing right now, Merrill?
Oh boy, there were probably a lot of people over the years. You know, somebody like a Reggie White, who was such a great, great player. You think of him. Andre Waters, who was the heart and soul of this team for a lot of years, one of the great defensive players. But there are others that you think about, too. Leonard Tose, who was as passionate an owner as you would ever find. Harry Gamble, who had been the president of the team for many years. So you think about people like that, and it would have meant so much to them. So, there are people like that for sure.
And who have you called or shared this experience with over the last couple of days? Who have you been reaching out to and having chit-chats about this finally happening?
I mean, almost everybody. My iPad exploded. my cell phone exploded. I was fortunate in that my wife, Cindy, and our daughter and her husband were at the game sitting up in the stands. And our son, Nolan, who is a film editor out in Hollywood, was able to come in the day before the game and, of course, spent the booth, the day in the booth as one of our statisticians. So he was with me during the game, and that's great to be able to hug your son at a moment like that. It was a great feeling.
Merrill Reese, longtime voice of the Eagles here on the Rich Eisen Show. What's the sort of job that Doug Peterson did that you saw up close and personal? What's something that he did that we might not know about that led to this, in your estimation, Merrill?
It had to be the most remarkable coaching job that I've ever seen. I go back to Dick Vermeil, who was one of the greatest coaches of all time, who I think belongs in the Hall of Fame. And when the Eagles won it in 80, not the Super Bowl, but won the NFC Championship in 80, they were predicted going into that season to be a contender. They were thought to be a team that could get there if everything went right and they got over the obstacle of the Dallas Cowboys. So that was not a shocker. And Andy Reid's team in 2004 had been to the NFC Championship before. In fact, in 2002, they were expected to be there when all they had to do was get over Tampa Bay in the last game ever played at Veterans Stadium. Mm. And it was almost a fait accompli because Tampa Bay could never win in cold weather. But the Eagles lost that, and that was a great disappointment. But that 2004 team was expected to get there, and I think even expected them to have a great shot at beating the Patriots and fell short. But this team, what I thought about this team going into the season, I thought they'd be pretty good. By pretty good, I thought they could win 9 or 10 games. And I thought they had a shot. They had a shot to take the division, but the Cowboys were still the team to beat. But I threw out the qualifying phrase, if they stay relatively healthy at key positions. But if you told me that this team was going to lose Jason Peters, their best offensive lineman, Jordan Hicks, their best linebacker, Darren Sproles, who did everything for this team, Caleb Sturgis, their kicker, their best special teamer, Chris Maragos, and then ultimately their MVP, Carson Wentz, I would have said they're going to be lucky to win 6 games. And here they are. They won 13 games. It was an amazing coaching job by Doug Peterson, the best I've ever seen. And each week, he would gather the team around and say on Monday, and he'd say to them, let's go 1-0. And he kept them focused on the next game, not let's win 6 before the bye or let's do this. Or even going into the championship game against the NFC Championship against Minnesota, he said nothing about Super Bowl. He focused strictly on that game. Let's go 1-0. And that stayed there throughout. And another thing, I've been through with teams, and as the games get bigger, you can see a little change in their personalities. They're a little tighter, a little more serious. This team never changed. I mean, I saw players in the lobby. I chatted with Nick Foles on Saturday afternoon, and he was as loose as he was during the season before he even became the starter, before Carson even went down. The guys had fun. I mean, they really had fun from beginning to end. Their demeanor never changed, and I think it all goes back to Doug Peterson keeping them on such an even keel.
A couple more minutes with Merrill Reese, the longtime voice of the Eagles. I'll give you, again, the floor here, Merrill. How do you respond? How do you think the Eagles will respond organizationally to the conversation that's already out there that they've got a quarterback controversy on their hands? Do they?
No, they don't. They have no quarterback controversy at all on their hands. Maybe it's a good talk show topic for local announcers. Maybe it's something that columns can be written about. But when Nick Foles took over, one of the first things Nick said privately and publicly and made no secret of, he said, this is Carson Wentz's team. He said, I'm in. I'm going to do the best I can possibly do. But keep in mind, this is Carson Wentz's team. And moving forward, going into next season, it is Carson Wentz's team, assuming he's healthy enough to come back when the season begins. And they think he will be. And it's Carson Wentz's team. He was your first draft choice. He was the face of the franchise, and that will not change. Now, what happens with Nick in the future remains to be seen, because you can think of all the possible scenarios. But Nick is an outstanding quarterback. But there is, and I'm speaking for me, and I'm sure Doug is saying the same thing if he were asked, this is Carson Wentz's team. I go back to the end of the season, and they had played that meaningless game in week 17 against the Dallas Cowboys. And Nick struggled around for a few series. And the next day, somebody asked Doug at his press conference, are you thinking of giving Nate Sudfeld a start. and that's what they were talking about then. And here is Nick, the Super Bowl MVP.
Unbelievable. Do you have a role in the parade, best you can tell? We can do
I haven't heard anything about my official role, but somebody told me that Mike Wick and I would be emceeing the parade.
Oh,
so
wow.
We'll see what happens. But whatever they want me to do, I'll do. I'm just happy to be part of this entire thing. It's just such a thrill and such a dream come true. But you know what? I've had so much excitement with this team over the years, so they didn't owe me a thing. It's for these fans. I mean, these fans, through thick and thin and thin and thin, they've invested their dollars, their hearts, their emotions, their passion, and finally, they realize their dream.
So when you say you'll do anything, would that include climbing a light pole, Merrill?
Anything that I could possibly do.
Okay. All right. So we don't have to worry about it.
I couldn't climb a ladder.
Merrill, congrats. Thanks for calling in.
Thank you.
Really
Rick.
Wanted to share this moment with you. And congratulations. Long time waiting of you calling all those games and so many people associating you with their heartbreak and exhilaration for you to be able to be at the mic for that big moment. Congrats.
Thanks, Rich. Great pleasure to speak with you.
As always, that's Merrill Reese.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern on Audience.